This tutorial shows how to conduct the paired samples t-test in SPSS and interpret its results. The purpose is testing the means for a paired or the same sample at two different points in time for differences. For instance, I let people do a 4-week long training and want to compare the number of push-ups they can do before and after the training. The requirements for the paired sample t-test are the following: two dependent measurements for the same individuals, a dependent variable on an interval or ratio scale, and an approximate normal distribution of the residuals. Testing for normal distribution is shown in a separate video linked in the info cards to keep this video more concise. Specifically in SPSS, your data needs to be in the white format. This means that the measurements are in separate variables, like you can see on your screen. You can conduct a paired samples t-test through Analyze, Means, and Proportions, and select the paired samples t-test. Take the variable containing your first measurement and drag it to the right to variable 1 in the paired variables box. Do the same for the variable with your second measurement. The options merely allow you to specify a confidence interval, which is set to 95% by default. Handling missing values can also be left at the default option of case-by-case exclusion. Use the bootstrap option if you run into trouble with the normality assumption. This will generate additional output. Please also make sure that the estimate effect sizes box is checked, which is a feature since SPSS 27. When it comes to the question which standardizer should be chosen, reporting the first two, standard deviation of the difference and corrected standard deviation of the difference, and adding a brief discussion of the implications is advised. Both will produce Cohen's D and Hedges correction of D, which we will discuss a bit later. The results will eventually be shown in the output viewer. You will by default get basic descriptive statistics consisting of the mean, the number of observations, the standard deviation, and the standard error of the mean. This will show you whether the means are potentially different or not. Next, you will see how the two measurements correlate with each other and whether this is significant or not. This information is usually not relevant, but nice to have. A high correlation also tells you that differences between the measurements are smaller. Now for the t-test itself. Depending on whether I test one-sided or two-sided, a different p-value should be looked at. Reminder, one-sided testing is applicable when you expect a certain outcome and want to test for it. For example, I expect a higher score after the intervention in T2, and since my descriptive statistics reveal that, looking at the one-sided p-value is appropriate. If you test for only a difference, use the two-sided p-value. If the p-value you have chosen is below the predefined threshold, for example 0.05, the null hypothesis can be rejected. Reminder, the null hypothesis assumes no difference of the mean between measurement 1 and 2 or before and after the intervention. The alternative hypothesis of the paired sample t-test is what you are actually proposing, one or two-sided results. In my case, I defined alpha as 0.05 and can therefore reject the null hypothesis. Since I'm testing one-sided, I'll focus on the one-sided p-value, which is very small with 7.68 × 10⁻¹ⁱ when I open the pivot table editor. Note, the two-sided p-value is always double of the one-sided p-value. Slight differences may occur due to rounding. I can conclude now that the means 22.04 and 25.24 are different. After a significant paired sample t-test, the effect size should also be looked at. Conveniently, SPSS also provides that output below. You're looking at the point estimate column for either Cohen's D or Hedges correction of D. As I already mentioned, you can get effect sizes for different standardizers in the calculation, meaning you will have two Cohen's D and two Hedges correction of D. Hedges correction will be a bit more conservative or biased. Take that with a grain of salt. For the purpose of transparency, I would advise reporting Cohen's D and Hedges correction of D despite the differences being small for each standardizer, standard deviation of the difference, and corrected standard deviation of the difference. Finally, you have to classify the magnitude of the effect. If similar studies in your research field exist, compare your effect size with the given one. If no comparable study exists, use the common thresholds within your research field. If those are also non-existent, you can refer to Cohen 92, a power primer. Page 157 shows three thresholds for the paired samples t-test: 0.2, 0.5 and 0.8 for small, medium and large effect sizes. In my example, the Hedges correction of Cohen's D is clearly above 0.8 and can be classified as a large effect for both standardizers. When you're done, you have to write up the results. The video that appears now will show you how.